Who? Who discovered this fascinating and important object in mathematics, which is the Bodler group. And the Bodler group, as you well know, in fact, there was a talk on SL2C, SL2Z, is the Z-fold matrix, but thought of as Möbius transform of matrices, 2x2 matrices with integer coefficients, determinant 1, but thought of as acting on the upper half plane by Möbius transformations, by these Möbius transformations. And we all know that a matrix and its negative give the same Möbius transformation, which just cancel the minus 1, and therefore the group that we realize is the projective PSL to Z, which is the group divided by the center. And this is even people, you hear many people work in string theory, and Witten speaks of modular invariants, and I was telling this morning about one time at CTP, Witten was giving a conference. I was sitting at the very back, and I asked one question. Is that modular invariant? I said, what a good question. And I felt red because all these young people from string theory turned around to see me. But to me, it was just a mathematical question. And I was telling Bernardo when we were trying, it was a very, very lucky question. But it's because for a mathematician, it's a natural object, this one. And the modular group can be shown to be generated by two transformations. This one and that one. Well, this one is clear. It's a translation by one unit. And the other one is, you see, this upper half plane has a privileged point, I. And this transformation is a hyperbolic rotation of 180 degrees around I. And these are two generators of this group. And you can immediately see that the fundamental domain is, it's not so easy, actually, to prove that. There's a beautiful proof by Jean-Pierre Serre, his famous book on arithmetic, but it's not so completely trivial, not very difficult, that this is the fundamental domain of this group. So if you take this group and see its image under the action of the modular group, you will tessellate the plane with this is a hyperbolic geodesic, this is a hyperbolic geodesic, so this is a geodesic triangle with angles 60 degrees, and zero. And this one tessellates like a kaleidoscope, because I think the best word for orbifolds, which is very popular here, should be in Spanish. Orbifold, I don't like, should be kaleidoscopio, which is, yeah, I know you don't like it, but it's the notation used by Montesinos. And so this gives you a beautiful object. And they compose not a unique way. And in fact, it's better to use a little bit this new generator. Use rotation by pi degrees around I, and you see this is a primitive cubic root of unit. So this is 120 degrees, the argument, and you can think of rotation of 2 pi over 3 around this. So you take the group generated, you take two points in the upper half plane whose distance, hyperbolic distance, is that one. Take any two points in hyperbolic plane. Around this point, take a rotation of 180 degrees. Around this point, take a rotation of 2 pi over 3. And the group you obtain is the modular group. I take the advantage to tell you that if you take two points which are closer, this generates a non-discrete group. The orbit becomes this. And if you take 2 points, it's an exercise for the students here, take 2 points, whose distance is bigger than this one, and take a rotation of pi around this, a rotation to pi over this, this generates a discrete group, but the quotient is a hyperbolic manifold of infinite area. Well, anyhow, this is just to tell you that this is a beautiful object, just from the geometric viewpoint, from the arithmetic viewpoint, and from many aspects of mathematics. And then, you think with these new generators, you think that this group is actually a this is a beautiful picture. This is the tessellation I was talking about. And with these generators, T and ST, you can show that the Bodler group is actually, as a group, as an abstract group, is the free product of the group with two elements by the group of three elements. So it is, as an abstract group, is C2, free product, so this is a, and well, my talk is about the following. If instead of considering the upper half plane in the complex plane, you consider the right hand side half space in the quaternionic, what we're going to try to develop this theory for this case. So I start by considering the following. So the actual title of my talk should have been Too Many H's. Why? Because I use H for Hamilton, H for Hurwitz, H for hyperbolic, H for harmonic, etc., 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 and I have a problem with tech. But that's just a joke. And actually, here you see that I have bold face H for hyperbolic, and this H, you see the quaternionic people stole from us hyperbolic people the H, and the one means that. So this is the set of quaternions whose real part is positive. You see, it's better than that because since there are three units, I, J, and K, it's not democratic. You use I, you use A, and therefore taking real part is the natural way. And actually, I will be always making mistakes talking of the upper half plane, when in reality I mean the right half, right hand half space, for dimensional space. And actually, well, these are, we will provide it with a hyperbolic metric. So naturally identification is this, is a set of four points. We of course identify R4 canonically with the quaternions, the natural. So R4 with a product, quaternionic product becomes H. And this is the Poincaré metric. I just gave a talk in Italy, and the actual name should be the Beltrami metric. Actually, is Riemann, his Abilitazione Schrift, gives this formula. The only metric he gives in this fantastic epoch-making is that one, the only one he gives. Yeah. The idea that everything, all you have to know is compute second derivatives, and everything is quadratic, which by default, but I know one, two mechanical things, but what I want to say, this is the only example of metric he gives, but actually an Italian mathematician of the first class, which is Beltrami, is the one that gives this. You see, everything becomes projective geometry at the very end, and that's the reason a course on projective geometry would never, never be taken out of the education, like, and even in France are doing that. So anyhow, this is, if you provide the upper half, the half space, the half space with this metric becomes...
But then it should be called the Brunelleschi metric.
The okay?
Brunelleschi metric.
See? Well, exactly. Yeah, exactly. That would be correct also. But the tradition is tradition. And this is actually an example of a complete metric space of constant negative curvature management. It's famous four-dimensional hyperbolic space. And, well, in this case, this is the upper half plane with the Poincaré metric, yeah, new name, Poincaré metric, if you are French, or the Lobachevsky metric. So I better use, in this case, the Lobachevsky. Lobachevsky. I look around, and I use the Lobachevsky metric, because becomes the plane with a constant negative curvature minus one. Okay. And now what I want to do is to take the analog of SL to Z. The first thing I need to do is to what is the notion? Another of the very, very important groups is the SL to R group. I mean, even Serge Lang has a book typing is exactly that, SL2R. And I remember when I was a graduate student, I had the fortune of meeting Blaine Lawson, an And I told him that I work on ANOSO systems, and also another great Russian mathematician, and the geodesic flow. And he said, you're working on those famous group of 2x2 matrices. I said, what? What is that? It's a very simple thing. And I didn't even know that it was the paradigm of a group. I mean, it was our decomposition, the representation theory is the paradigm of a group. It's something that should be make a big part of the education of every mathematician. But at the moment, I thought it was just a simple high school group, no? Anyhow, what happened now if I do the same thing with the group of quaternions? So I will consider GL to H, the group of 2x2 invertible matrices, but that we enter in the quaternion. So you can think of that as a matrix with four A, B, C, D quaternions. So you can think also as a matrix acting in H2, but be careful, you have to multiplication on the right, not the other side. And you can think of it actually as a matrix, A but A matrix. No, that's what it. But for the moment, it's just A, B, C, D, but it's a quaternion, and they act on vectors A, B, very carefully acting on the left, multiplying on the left. But I will explain a little bit. So actually, you can say that they are, it's not singular if they don't have has a non-vanishing Euler term. Forget about it. Think of it as an A by A matrix, and if the determinant is not zero, it's invertible. And this is a group. It's a very interesting group. And actually, I want the notion of Möbius transformation. So the first thing is to compactify R4, namely H, adding one point, this canonical construction of Riemann, to obtain the sphere S4. And then I consider the group of Möbius transformations. And look at this exactly like that. Remember AZ plus B divided by CZ plus D? Well, in the same formula, except it's like politics. You have to choose the left or the right very carefully. Like, for instance, you are in a country like United States, and you have to give you a random example, you have to be very good which candidate you choose. And here we use as multiplication exactly like that. A on the left, C on the left, inverse on the right, not any other way around. And these are Möbius transformations, okay? And you can think of this as a projectivization of the 2x2 matrices. I will explain a little bit later. And you use you have the natural convention at infinity. So this map, given a matrix, non-singular matrix A, B, C, D, in a natural way, it acts as a diffeomorphism of the sphere. And the set of all matrices like that actually is a group. It's a group of dimension, well, 4 times 4 is 16, minus 1, because I projectivize. No? It is actually, it's a group like that. See, remember that before I used to divide by plus or minus 1 to go from SL to...
So this is because of the Hopf federation?
See, comes with Hopf. Well, comes related to what you told. Penrose is a fantastic thing. And to get P3 and the Penrose vibration, I think is a quaternionic version is absolutely beautiful. And to get hyperkabir, this is beautiful because you have I, J, and K, which are integrable complex structures which satisfy the quaternionic relations.
That's right.
So it's beautiful, not? It's related. I think Hamilton thought of this as a great invention, not Hamiltonian mechanics. That was a remark to him. But quaternions, that was for him the real subject. And since I want to put more pepper and salt to this conference I already gave, let me tell you, once I asked Dennis Sullivan that the dream of every student is to develop quaternionic calculus, no? Duvivier's theorem, the Riemann mapping theorem, quaternionic Riemann mapping theorem. I want to prove the Poincaré conjecture using that, but I was only 18, no? And there's a famous theorem by Duvivier that say that any locally conformal map in Rn, when n is greater than 2, is actually a Möbius transformation. So a little, is this conformal in a tiny little open piece? It's global, can be extended globally. It's a beautiful theorem by Duvivier, and that doesn't work. But then Dennis Sullivan said it, I told him it's too bad nobody can develop. But he said, no, you're wrong. Actually, the whole of Donaldson's theory in dimension 4 can be thought of as a really victory of quaternions, because it works because of quaternions. I was never able to actually see the connection, but he claims it's true. I think it's true. Dimension 4 is special, and that
is related to the Twistor program.
Is it related to the Twistor program? Exactly. And the double vibration, flat band. Well, anyhow, I spoke a lot to tell you that this is actually makes sense, and it acts on the sphere. And it's very beautiful. It's actually this group, MP, the group of Möbius transformations, preserves the sphere, acts as diffeomorphies, which beautifully preserve angles and orientation. So this is the group of conformal transformations of the sphere. And it's beautiful that there is a formula, and you can actually prove that it has dimension 15. You remember? It was 4, 4, 4, minus this. And now there's a beautiful theorem, which is actually due to Poincaré, is if you have the sphere dimension n, and you have a conformal transformation, well, first there's a theorem of high school, and I want to repeat the joke that I always make, Russian high school, not in Mexico, which tells you that any conformal transformation is a composition of inversions of spheres. It's something that we should learn in first year in Mexico, in first year university, maybe in Russian high school. And that means that you can actually use that fact to prove that any conformal transformation of the sphere extends to a conformal transformation of the disk of the dimension 4, or dimension 5, okay, whose boundary is S4. And if it has conformally orientation preserving on the disk of dimension 5, actually acts by hyperbolic isometries. And therefore, just by this formula that I gave you, you are describing the group of all isometries of hyperbolic space to dimension 5. Mm-hmm. Well, let's check dimension just for the, it's easy to see that you can go from any point to, you have the five dimensional sphere. It's easy to see you can go from any point to any point. But more than that, you can take any frame and take it to another frame. And therefore, you count dimensions, it's the group S, so it's five dimensional times SO5, you pay 15. But anyhow, this is the group, okay. And this formula one learns in, remember our Alfor, so any book on complex variables? If you take a Möbius transformation of this type, with T theta is a real number, multiplied pi, and A is a complex number of norm less than, of modulus less than one, this is a group of Möbius transformations that preserve the unit disk in the complex plane. And then maybe there's an analog in. And I discovered actually, and they never published it, I think it was well known, that this is actually the form, look at the analogy of that with that. It's the same thing. You see this one is that one, no? Except you're writing in the right order, and instead of one unit complex number, you have two units quaternions, namely two points in S3. Well, this is the group of Möbius transformations that preserve the unit ball in the quaternions. The four-dimensional ball in the quaternions is that one. And therefore it acts on the boundary, and therefore this is the group of isometries of the four-dimensional hyperbolic space. And if you restrict that action on the boundary S3, it acts as conformal transformation. So all conformal geometry of the sphere can be actually put in a formula.
From this you can get all Blaschke transformations.
Beautiful. For instance, now you take the product of this transformation, you get Blaschke, and there's a whole theory. I just came from Florence, and they are actually in Sindesta there was a group. Well, there is a group still of quaternionic people like Shapiro. And there's the counterpart, is the Italian. They have different viewpoints. They are more interested in slash regular functions. But actually they developed the theory of Blaschke product, and it's essentially, you take the product of functions like that, you get quaternionic mass from the disk to the disk, and it's a beautiful theory. And Rinne's work. Well, now this preserves the hyper. If you take a unit disk in R4, remember I will always speak of R4 as if it was H, for H as it was R for quaternions equal R four. And well, the metric is this famous metric, which is known to is the Lobachevsky Poincaré metric. And therefore, the group of transformations like the ones I described, let's count dimensions. Well, Q has module less than one, so varies in the ball, has dimension four. And U and V vary on the sphere, so 3 R 3 6 is dimension 10. And exactly the group of sizes. And you can work, and it's just a check. No? And well, therefore, this is a group of isometries of the ball. And well, there's a KV transform. So I can go from the ball to the upper half plane, like remember it's the right hand plane of continuous of positive real part, back and forth, and do geometry of the ball. You see, for my students, hyperbolic geometry, I tell you there's the disk model, there's the upper half model, there's the Klein model, in which lines are lines. This projective model, because it's the set of projective transformations that preserve a quadric, and you have the Lorentz model, and you go back and forth. The upper half plane is fantastic for computed angles. The Klein model is fantastic to prove that a convex set is convex. The Lorentz model is fantastic for, which the physicists claim is the Sitter model, no, it's not the Sitter, it's the Minkowski. You have to defend mathematicians, the priority, the Minkowski model. And you go back and forth, and I want to convey to my students, the young people that are here, the fact that mathematics is interconnected. I know my students are here, he was a game. But mathematics all interconnected, so this is interconnected with several things. And well, I have that one. The KV transform allowed me to go from one to the other. And okay, so here comes so I describe to you GL2H quotient diagonal positive matrices is the group of conformal transformation of the spheres. And here comes something interesting. According to Alfors, it was Carl Theodor Valin, who was one of the most horrible persons as a personality, an opportunist and a Nazi element, and maybe Hausdorff died because of him. But we're talking about mathematics, so let's forget about that. He created one thing, and what he created was the, we're not judging his political, he did one thing, that was the use of Clifford numbers to describe Möbius transformations. And it's a paper that I took, it's in German. And it was rested for a long, long time until in 1984, Alfors pushed forward the idea of Valin and considered groups of 2x2 Clifford matches given the necessary and sufficient conditions to leave have invariant half space. And therefore he had formulas using Clifford numbers to describe hyperbolic isometries of half spaces. And I know here also he established a group of Clifford people, and therefore this is one of which quaternions is one example. And well, there's something interesting because the two people from Florence, which were in my birthday and you met. Well, no, Graziano Gentile and Cinzia Bisi, Italian, reformulated the condition of Alfors and Parker and reduced it to a single condition. So the problem is let A, B, C, D be quaternionic matrices. A, B, C, non-singular quaternionic matrices, thought of as Möbius transformations. Problem, when does this matrix preserve the half space of quaternions of positive real part? That's the problem. What's the restriction? Is the analog in complex is you take SL2C, PSL2C is the group of Möbius transformations of the sphere, the group of automorphisms of the Riemann sphere. So you see, here you are doing hyperbolic geometry, complex variables, conformal geometry, everything put in a single aspect, many aspects. No? And here you ask, let A, B, C, D be a quaternionic matrix. What conditions I have to impose in such a way this preserves the half space. These are the conditions. It's simply this condition, and transpose is transpose. No, the usual, same are transposing quaternionic numbers, but it's the same thing. And the bar is the quaternionic bar. Namely, leave the real part untouched and change the sign of the imaginary part. That's it. And this condition is necessarily a sufficient condition where A, K is this matrix. Very special number. Actually, if you take this matrix, or I will explain a little bit, and if you do it coordinate by coordinates, here, well, I was giving a talk at Trieste, and there was Parker there. I said, well, I did that before. And so I say, now I call it the Parker, Alphys Parker, right? Because I didn't know that. And well, if you take this condition here, it's one single matrix condition, it's equivalent to these conditions. Notice that the determinant is this one. It's not, it's not AD minus EB. Or things don't commute, so you have to be careful. So these are the conditions. So a matrix A, B, C, D induces
no minus signs.
Okay, no minus, exactly, one observation, see? And so it's very interesting that. So this group acts by orientation. The theorem is matrix that satisfies the BG condition, B for BC Gentili, satisfy, preserve the half space, and therefore presents the boundary. So let's see, for our own sake, let's think of the floor as being of dimension 3, and being the pure imaginary quaternions. And everything above it is the half space. Okay? And for instance, one is here. One is a quaternion with positive real part equal to one. And there in the floor, you have R4 with generators I, J, K. Remember perhaps we used that in high school for four, what's this? I, J, K, and that one. And that's our universe. Okay? It's the analog of that. But for dimension analog of that. And so, this group acts as hyperbolic isometrics, orientation preserving hyperbolic isometrics on the half space, and therefore on the boundary as a conformal transformations. Okay, with the convention of infinity that I told you. So, you have this relation, the set of isometries, see. And now, what I really want to do is to make sense to P, S, L to Z, the modular group. Remember that you take the upper half plane and take it squashing under the modular group, you get a fantastic object, the modular orbifold, which is the modular space of elliptic curves. And I ask a question here, maybe the space we describe is modular space of quaternionic torus. I'm working on that, but okay. So in fact, quaternionic groups have been thought of, but not with the detail and the depth we have done it. So we want to generalize that. So I have to ask the question, what on earth are the integers? What would play the role of the integers? Unfortunately, there's two canonical choices, which are the Lipschitz integers, which is simply the set of four quaternions with integer entries, and that is actually a ring. It's closed under quaternionic multiplication, and determines a lattice. A lattice, all this, and I can think therefore of matrices A, B, C, D, where A, B, C, D are Lipschitz integers. But be careful, that has to be compatible with the BG conditions, because I want them to preserve the half space. So for the moment I have that, and then I have another beautiful group, which is the Hurwitz integers, and these are quaternions, such that either all the coefficients are half integers, or all integers, nothing half and half. It's very democratic. And then when I saw that for the first time, I say, I bet you that's not a ring, multiply two, it's going to be out to one half. No. And then you go to Wikipedia and you see. And you learn something interesting also for the young people. You see, Lipschitz for you, or for me, when I was a student, was a constant. And Hurwitz was a little maybe I didn't even know exactly what it is. And then you're talking of two great mathematicians whose complete works are thick. No? And therefore, Hurwitz invented this group. Well, actually, why did Lipschitz invent his integers? Well, because he wanted to prove that every integer is the sum of four squares. This is just perfect to do it. And Hurwitz invented it, well, for different reasons, but that's, you see. So, and therefore I can say, well, now I take quaternionic pages, entries in the Lipschitz integers or quaternionic integers respectively, and see what happens. Can I find the tessellation? What can I do? Etc. That's the object, you see. Well, it can prove that actually this is a ring. You don't believe it, but it's a ring. You go to Wikipedia, and it's the ring of quaternions. Therefore, as an additive group, is free abelian of rank 4, and it gives you a lattice, a little tilted. It's not a cubic lattice, it's a little tilted, but still very beautiful. And of course, every Lipschitz quaternion is a Hurwitz quaternion, so always with all our integers, and it's a subgroup of that. And now I want to prove, remember this beautiful formula, is the Bodler group is generated by what? Translation by 1 and rotation by 180 degrees. Since I don't know which integer matrix is, now integer means Hurwitz or Lipschitz, preserve the upper hand plane, I'm going to do it the other way. I'm going to consider the group which consists of translations by integer purely imaginary quaternions, therefore if preserved, and then I will take the inversion around the point I. It's a symmetric space. It's the map that inverses geodesics going to 1. 1 now is the I of that 1. And therefore, we see that that if you translate by a quaternion which has real part 0, then the purely imaginary, then preserves. It's an isometry. And actually, a matrix is written that way. No, the translation is 1, is that 1. And now we consider when omega is the real imaginary part. You see, the imaginary part of a Lipschitz quaternion is a Lipschitz quaternion. The first coefficient is 0. But the imaginary part of a Hurwitz quaternion is not a Hurwitz quaternion, because 1/2, 1/2, 1/2, 0. 0 is not half an integer, it's an integer. Of course, be careful with the definition, but okay? So, you have to be careful, you have that. And you have here, therefore, the translation. And, well, you see, there are translations that don't preserve the whole half plane. For instance, translate by 1, well, it takes the half space into a subset of the half space. Therefore, the translations allowed are only those which are purely imaginary. And I take the group like that. This is just the definition. You know, translate by imaginary, purely imaginary translations. And this I go fast. This group of translations has freely, properly, and what's a fundamental domain? A fundamental domain is you take the unit cube, take the chimney on top of that, and translate it. Therefore, the quotient will be as a manifold, the torus, 3 torus, as a cross section is a torus, 3 torus, cross R. But when you go up, the volume tends to 0. And when you go down, the volume tends to infinity, and we have the right to call that trumpet. Like Mexican mariachis, you know. The cost tends to 0. But a trumpet has a cross section, which is a circle, and our trumpets have a cross section, which is a torus, you know, dimension 3. And therefore you have this trumpet, no, that it becomes a cost, and when you go to 0, it becomes a torus who grows enormously. And that's it's just a very observation, because to tell you when I like to draw the Bodler orbifold, which is an object I love. Well, as an orbifold looks like that, has a cusp. Near that, it looks like Saint Lucia. It's isomorphic to the has two conic points. One of conic angle pi, the other of conic angle 2 pi. These two actually correspond to the lattice, square lattice and exactly and honeycomb hexagonal lattice. And well, anyhow, this group acts freely and is abelian, all the things like fundamental domain, I told you what it is, chimney, and now enter into z goes to minus 1 over z rotation of, in this case, becomes beautiful, simply becomes.
But no sign.
Comma?
No sign.
No sign, and exactly, just q minus 1. Inversion in the field, non-commuted field of quaternions. And that leaves invariant the upper half place, upper half space, and is an inversion around 1. Reverse orientations. Which, by the way, by conjugation, this proves that H is a symmetric space, which we all know. But anyhow, will be an exercise for students. And it has a corresponding matrix. And the matrix is this. It's exactly the same matrix that was used by Gentili and Graziano. So now, my Lipschitz group will be generated by matrix 1, W, 0, 1, W real part, you know, upper triangular matrix, and this matrix. And this one of our theorems, it's a theorem, trivial, to prove that this is exactly the subgroup of matrices, quaternionic conformal maps in GL4H, which preserve the half space. And this is beautiful. And this is automatically discrete because the group is discrete. You know, you put a student, prove that SL2Z is discrete. And then you realize that integers are discrete, and therefore the group is discrete. But I was trying to give a proof, I said that. And then you realize that an integer matrix, you cannot move a lot, eh? Remaining in the integers, not in the apps. See, this is kind of thing that you say, no. Well, anyhow, it's a discrete group. And well, here I describe T, forget about it. It's inverse orientation, it's, you know, it does that. But the fundamental domain of that is what? Well, you take one. Remember, think of that as three dimension. Take one. And take the sphere of radius 1 at 0. And what you have is what I call an igloo, because it's half sphere of dimension 3. And this one is it's actually a hyperbolic hyperplane, and divides in two pieces, what's under the igloo, what's up in the igloo, and this rotation interchanges the, has a very natural fundamental domain, it's half space, no? And, well, here's plenty. And now, well, my first picture, remember, well, I Mexican, that could be Italian. This is the fundamental domain. And what would be the, now take the igloo, so this is a schematic picture, this is a R4, I take the half sphere, and then, in R3, I take the cube of length 1, center at 0. And then from there, I take planes which are perpendicular. But it's the same thing that I do in here. You see, what do you do here? You have these two points, and you draw two lines. And you take everything that is above the half circle. Okay? I do the same thing. You see the analogy of that. And the, well, if you take that, you compute the dihedral angles, and you see that, well, the walls meet at 90 degrees, and the walls touch the sphere in 60 degrees, and therefore you have a convex polytope with the number of faces you can compute, which satisfies the Poincaré theorem that has dihedral angles that are rational multiples of pi. And therefore you take the group of reflections, tick, 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 you tessellate H4, the hyperbolic force space, you have a tessellation. But of course, if you take the group generated by this reflection, actually, inverses orientation. But if you take the group generated by even number of reflections, now you have a group. But now the fundamental domain becomes that. You see, if you take inversion Q goes to Q minus 1 of this chimney, it becomes this chimney. Going up, going down. And therefore this is also a Poincaré polyhedron, and it tessellates, you know, gives you a mosaic, you know, a kaleidoscopic structure, and that's therefore a group, no? By the way, well, if I have taken A, B, C, D, Lipschitz integers, that's a discrete, doesn't preserve the half space, I don't care, but it acts discretely on the sphere S4, and therefore it acts properly and discontinuously on H5, on the interior. And therefore I have examples of orbifolds of dimension 5, finite volume, automatically. Mm-hmm. Not, well, automatically, you have to prove it. But, and therefore, you can see that you can multiply, you see, remember that the new generators of a Bodler group were translation by 1 and rotation of I. And as I say S times T, is of order 3, is the new generators. Therefore, translation composed by that rotation is an important option. But now we're in the quaternion, so you can multiply on the left or on the right. And therefore, this represents translation of this Q as Q minus 1. And I can put it on the left or on the right, and I have these two matrices. And that's the R and L. And now, remember I told you 1 is order 2, order is order 3. And now, amazingly, you have elements of order. You see, like that. This one to the 6. So now, S followed by T will be of order 6, not order 3. And therefore, this group won't be the free product of C2, C3. It's a complicated group with many, with the numbers 2 and 3 enter, magic numbers 2 and 3 enter. And so this is, okay? So the order of left or right depends on what unit take. W can be a unit or can be, so has order 3. Well, this is all that I go fast. And that's the definition. The group generated by translations, by pure imaginaries and Q, is called the Lipschitz group. And also we will define the Hurwitz group in the same. So all this word, all this what it says, this is the group of matrices with Lipschitz entries, which preserve is a complete analog of Bessel to Z. But actually, it's better to think of Hurwitz because Hurwitz is bigger. So the set group generated by imaginary parts of Hurwitz quaternions and Q generates a group.
But what's going on with the inclusion of the complex numbers in the quaternions?
Beautiful question. Suppose that I only take matrices. Don't use A. Please don't use I, J, K. I let you know I use matrices with reals and J's. So it's a slice. And like that.
That's right.
And not only that, think of the Forteca, you see...
But what happens between the difference between Hurwitz and Lipschitz on the slice?
On the slice, it's a different discrete group of finite area. I think the following way. Look at the floor. You do that when nobody's looking. You look at the floor, or if they look at you, pretend you are doing exercise. Like if you are in the post, you're a mathematician, you're in the post doing mathematics, topology, and there a lady looks at you, you pretend that you are doing exercise. And that works, you know, and then you go back to you. I've done that. So you look at them, the imaginary quaternions, and look at the lattice of integers, imaginary quaternions, and take a line going to one of these points, and take the plane on that. And that is a copy of, see, and then you would have the maybe it's invariant of the group, and you have, it's a very beautiful question, have many, many copies, slices give you copies of Riemann surfaces, is the question. And depends on the arithmetic of that. And very interesting. Well, okay, so now, there's a beautiful, the in is a ring, so we might think of the units are algebraically, and the Hurwitz units are that one, those eight, plus minus one, plus minus I, plus minus J, plus minus I. And these conditions are satisfied, and this group is non-abelian group for the eight, and the group of Möbius transformations corresponding to that corresponds to that. It's very interesting because as a Möbius, as a complex Möbius transformation, this is the identity. But as a quaternion transformation, it is not the identity. And so that put noise into our problem that our fundamental domain had to be redefined. It's a through probe. These are the properties, no? How these things act, let me go faster. What is interesting is, you see, in the affine group, for PSL to R, our matrix A, B, 0, A minus 1. And it's the group of affine transformation of the real line. And here is more fascinating because you have more structure. And therefore you can speak of the affine group. The affine group is, think of it as the following. Take 1, and take the R3, which is parallel to the floor. It's an R3, it's called a horosphere. And the group that preserves that, of isometries, is a fine group. And the group of units does a beautiful geometry. There's a new ingredient, is what I would say. The fine group, and this is given like that. You know, remember A. It's kind of given, it's a little more sophisticated. Let me go a little faster. Well, we do a lot of things in this paper, it has about 60 pages. We do you see the affine group coincides with the group of conformal transformations of R3, and therefore has dimension 7. And well, let me go faster. Now define the, okay, let me go here. My time is coming. Now it's more interesting the Hurwitz units. So the Lipschitz units were plus minus 1, plus minus I, plus minus J, plus minus J. I'm going. And this group of units, of Hurwitz units, has order 24. Okay. Now I think of the following thing. You have the quaternions. If you take 0, that's H star, is a multiplicative group, non-commutative. And you have this, the group of units of that is the unit sphere, is 3. But the group of unit Hurwitz is a group of order 24. Then consider this group. This group is in the unit sphere, and you have 24 points in the unit sphere. As I learned directly from Arnold when he visited Italy, once you see that group acting on the sphere, take the convex hull of these points. And you have a regular polytope of dimension 4. Beautiful polytope. And if you had taken, for instance, the binary of the Hahedral group, you have exactly what can be considered as a four-dimensional football. So my student Juan Pablo, who is a collaborator of this paper, presented his PhD on the Bradley thesis on regular polytopes in Guanajuato. And once he finished his presentation, it was very good. Gomez Mont, a Mexican mathematician, asked the audience, are there any questions? Nobody asked. And the family was behind. And the family wants to ask a question, and an uncle say, what's that used for? Classical question. And I asked, it was a little before the World Cup in South Africa. And I repeated, say, without the knowledge, deep knowledge of this, it's impossible the construction of a soccer ball. Oh. there was Arturo Ramirez, which is a very good mathematician, who was thinking of the following answer. What's the use of the Ninth Symphony of Beethoven? That's very romantic, but wouldn't have worked as well as my answer. My answer was devastating, was complete. Oh, sure, no? Anyhow, I tell you that because that, going back to my lecture, you have now a regular polytope with 24 verses. You take the convex hull, and this is called the 24 cell. It has fantastic structure, geometric. It's a fantastic geometric structure. Well, this group is already 24. It's known as the binary tetrahedral group. its elements can be seen as the vertices of a 24 cell. It is a complex regular polytop whose boundary is composed. I know the, when you take this complex hole, the faces are three-dimensional. You know what they are? They are regular octahedral of dimension 3. And you can see the combinatorics. At each point, you have six of these. And they meet orthogonally. It's an orthosystem. This beautiful, they meet. And therefore, you build the thing. Once I have this polytope, like Escher, I start reflecting, ting, 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 ting. And maybe I can get a series of beautiful hyperbolic four-dimensional manifolds. And that's what we do in this paper. Actually, this paper can be thought of as a... but the difference is that we are in formulas and we're using the quaternions to do it.
So this is kind of the first Fuchsian...
This is the first Fuchsian quaternionic groups. Okay. Exactly. You can think of Escher, a quaternionic Escher construction, more or less, no? Maybe for art, maybe more people in art will come if I saw. And then, well, you see, now you can take that and use the Kenny transform, and then you have the unitary group, the same thing I did here. You have the affine for this group, you know, etc., etc. And now the only thing we have is, so we have defined two candidates for PSL2Z, the famous modular group. We have the right to call quaternionic modular groups. One is bigger than the other. The Hurwitz contains the ellipses, and it's of order 3, and contains lots of geometry. And now we want to know what are the orbifolds. Like here, well, was very concrete, has two singular points, one cusp. And now it will be very complicated, the structure, because you have singularities which are zero-dimensional, one-dimensional, two-dimensional. You have to take care of... it's because very stacky. Now you like that, because you have to take good care of the isotopic groups. So it's exactly what... The orbifold is okay, but it's, you have to be thinking of the isotopic groups at a different stage. You know? And these are fascinating, with groups for the 2, for the 4, for the 3, for the 6, and okay. Well, this is, we continue that, huh? Let me see, what is this? Well, this is will be the equations of the chimney, the analog of the fundamental domain, except since now there are units, this won't be a fundamental domain. You still have to subdivide this cube, because the group doesn't act freely on that. In this case, you go out of the end. But in this case, you still inside, so you have to subdivide, you can really have a fundamental domain. And therefore, let me present you, I go a little quicker to, I know, I'm taking a mistake. Wait. Well, these are the equations of those hyperplanes. Forget about it, define this. And this is the fundamental domain, actually. You see, you have the igloo, you have the cube in the imaginary part, you divide the cube into 8 equal cubes, take two opposite, you can take one and adjust it to the other, but it's better for, you take two opposite cubes, like that, and take the chimneys over that, and the things that are above the igloo, and that's a fundamental domain of the ellipses. More complicated, and that's because the units are acting there. And then, actually, for the Hurwitz group, this is the fundamental domain. Two square pyramids. And then you analyze, you have the group paths, you have the many rotations by 3, by 6, you make an exhaustive analysis of what happens. It's too long. Well, you have fundamental domain. I want to go faster.
But you're describing this orbifold. You're describing this orbifold.
You're describing the orbifold. Exactly. Forget about it. I'm not gonna. Don't worry. I'm gonna go fast. So I'm gonna cancel.
And from this, you would have all the lattice of the complex of work groups and everything.
Exactly. And then I will describe the Kenyon graph of that. I'll give you the presentation of the group, and we have to write it because we have to go on to get it published.
Yeah.
And with Poincaré, maybe he can afford to what a great man. He used to send, by the way, he used to send the comrade you And I found a little mistakes in another note to comprehend you. No, no, it's not quite like that. And then another one, and then finally it was fixed. But it was another way of doing mathematics. Fantastic. I recommend you to go to YouTube and see the fantastic exposition by Etienne Gis of the work of Poincaré. It's worth it. By the way, propaganda, next January is the 20th anniversary of Cuernavaca. And there will be a big conference, and Etienne Gis is coming. And he's one of the best expositors of mathematics on the earth. Worth of giving an exposition very close to here. Maybe here, one of these days. It's fantastic. Now he's taking 3 months in Brazil every year. And I'm envious because I think we can maybe get him to have 1 month here. Okay, well, anyhow. Now all these calculations, remember I told you the fundamental domain is that it was not easy. So we take from Jean-Pierre Serre his proof. And in a non-trivial way, because it's non-commutative, introduces problems, all these blah, 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 prove that it's actually the fundamental domain. Once you have the fundamental domain, you let the group act, you can construct the KV graph, and you can actually give the group by generators and relations. And that's what we do. These are the generators are translation by I, translation by J, translation by K, and Q goes to Q minus 1. And then what relation do we have? And this is the group. These are not optimal relations. There are less relations, but it's still very, very complicated group. Not Z2, free product Z3, much more complicated. And, well, you have the presentation. And the Hurwitz group is a little longer. No? But this also maybe have the relation necessary. We haven't analyzed it. And here are the orbifolds. And the orbifolds, you compute the Euler characteristic in the orbifold sense, like Atiyah. And you prove, thank goodness, that one is three times the other. When we saw that, we're fascinated, we were right. Because it has to be multiplicative. And one is a subgroup index three of the other. So we're very happy. And, well, anyhow, these groups, these Escher groups, will give rise.
What numbers do you get?
What?
What numbers do you get for me?
No. As far as I know, no.
What
no?
Numbers?
No, what
numbers is the last
characteristic? Ah, 180. 180, let me see, maybe here is 192 and three times that. Something like that. Not trivial, very, very complicated, see. It's not two or three, it's big numbers. Well, here we do all the program with the local balls of the ship, compute the final volumes, the orbifold. And then there's a beautiful theorem that I recall of Selberg tells you under this condition, because these groups have torsion. And therefore they produce orbifolds, not manifolds. And this beautiful theorem by Selberg tells these groups have finite index subgroups which are freely, hence by obtaining manifolds of finite volume. No? And then, well, actually, these theorems in a different way were given by Radcliffe and Chan. I know Radcliffe's father is Mexican, so he speaks a little, he went to Guanajuato. So they given examples of that. Okay. So, Radcliffe has found 100. They found a lot of manifolds, but we find them in an arithmetic way. So I have the right to call these arithmetic groups that I can find by. And anyhow, this is a beautiful picture. This is the projection of the 24 cell in R3, and here's the combinatorics of the 24 cell.
I thought you were becoming New Age.
Hello?
I thought you were becoming New Age or something.
See, very well, almost, exactly. Well, anyhow, you can pair the faces of these 24 cells. Remember, the faces are regular octahedron to obtain hyperbolic manifolds. Or, and you know, the ends of hyperbolic 3 manifolds are optofinite cover of the form torus. Remember what I told you, the trumpet? Are trumpets. Or maybe crystallographic. And therefore, you can fill the holes. By filling the holes, you replace, cut it to T3, pack. And T3 is the boundary of, in R4, is the boundary of a torus, of a tubular neighborhood of a torus. Of trivial embedded, with trivial normal bond. So you have T2 in S4, the boundary is D2 cross the torus, therefore the boundary is T3, you glue that. And we have found examples where if you do that, you get S4. Beautiful, because that means the follow. That means that it is 4. You have an example of, and that's roughly fine, but we do it arithmetically, and we get two examples also. You have 5 tori. I don't know if you remember the theorem by, beautiful theorem by Thorstein, the Borromean rings complement is hyperbolic 3 manifold. And these are Borromean rings, unlinked and unknotted. The definition of knot is different. In such a way that the complement is hyperbolic for dimension, so the analog of that. And we do that, and with that, this Escher, this is a schematic by Royce, beautiful. That's the world that you see. So if you take a trip through hyperbolic quaternionic space, you see fantastic things. The thing of finding this manifold is as follows, is the 24th cell still has a subdivision by pieces that are the ones that generate all these fantastic four dimensions. I have a whole list of manifolds. And many things that you are thinking about, you know, when I give a talk in the TST, I prevented myself. I say, by the way, we have thought about Bianchi groups, Hilbert surfaces, modular forms. So I give a list of things they could ask, and I wanted priority. We have thought about it, which is true. We have thought about it, we haven't obtained anything. I didn't say that. We so far haven't obtained anything. But it's a whole world of problems. Particular one that I'm interested in is where these manifolds are modular spaces of quaternionic tori. So the group from Florence have developed a theory of quaternionic tori. And one dimensional quaternionic, so a dimension 4. And it's a beautiful theory that I developed, like your question of Plaschke probes. There's a whole things you can do of slice regular functions. And that's I'm working on that also, it's another aspect. And anyhow, with that I finish this thing a little bit after the time, but thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions or comments? I have one question actually.
Yes,
from the very silly arithmetic point of view, Horvitz quaternions are a little bit nicer because you can do division with remainder. Does that somehow affect properties, comparative properties of the group you are considering between Horvitz and Lipschitz?
I haven't thought about it, but it's a very beautiful question. It makes sense. But thank you very much, a very good observation. Let me think about it. But anyhow, very, very nice.
Rich, any other questions? Rich, let's...
By the way, this paper is available in archive if you want to see it. So,
excellent. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
We take a break.